Well, welcome to the video, everyone. It's great to be here with among friends. It's really amazing that we still have like about 40 to 50 to 60 viewers of these videos. That's actually quite extraordinary, given the content here. It really requires a repentant mind to appreciate these videos. A repentant mind is really a mind that has leverage over the ego, the egoic absurdity that the mind is engaging in, pretending that it's not the mind. That's what, it's maybe a better definition we've ever had before of what repentance really is. You get leverage over the ego, and you can say, ego, not now, maybe later. I'm not listening to you. And the ego has to back off. The ego is like this contentious part of our mind that contends with truth. It's in contention with truth. And so it's defending absurdity. And what it does is it simply causes us to spin our wheels or wander aimlessly, and we get nowhere. So before repentance, you can study, you get nowhere. You don't have the leverage. The ego has leverage over you, has leverage over us. But when we get leverage over the ego, it completely changes our lives. And we start to compound momentum. We start to build up momentum and keep compounding and getting more and more leverage, and our momentum gets better and better and better. And what happens is what we are experiencing sticks with us and gets clearer and clearer, and familiarity builds up. Whereas like if the ego has leverage over us, we might do some study, have an experience, this and that, and then the ego says, well, you got to do some other stuff, and before you know it, it's been a week or a month or whatever, or a year. And then you go back to it, and it's like, whoa, what happened? You lost the familiarity is what happened. So the familiarity is the key. It is absolutely the key for us. When you have leverage over the ego, you're able to practice every day. And practicing every day, you build in this familiarity. So I'm familiar with what I did yesterday and the day before. It keeps it fresh. And you go back to it and say, oh yeah, that's familiar to me. But if you go like a week or so or longer, the familiarity, it starts to fade away. And you say, oh, I have to do it all over again. So it feels like you're starting over every time, and it's too difficult. So the ego says, oh, well, you're trying the spiritual path. You're just no good at it. It's too difficult for you. That's not true. It's that the ego has leverage over you to get you to stop practicing every day and have these long breaks so you lose the familiarity. That's what's really happening to people in the world. Okay, this is our trouble. So for me, I got leverage over the ego. That happened in 1978, the autumn of 1978, where I spontaneously had the remembrance of my previous lives. I didn't see it coming. It just happened. And that lit a fire under me, a blazing fire, a blowtorch of determination, because I realized that death doesn't solve anything. And ego has been lying to me about death all along. And I realized if I don't get free of the ego and this absurdity and this suffering, misery, if I don't really get free of it, I'm going to continue on with it in another life here, and be, the cycles keep continuing. And that just absolutely, lit that fire under me, and the fire's never gone out since then. Right from there. And so it's been 38 years, I guess you would say, of this intense determination. But I found out then I had leverage over the ego, because I realized, ego, you're lying to me. You're absolutely lying. You said, what the ego does is tell us, look, just take it easy, get through this life, try not to be too bored, and when you die, that's it. You either there's nothing happens after that, and you just don't exist anymore, or you go to heaven, one of the two, but that's it. And so this is what most people do. They just try to get by and not get too bored, because boredom is a horrible experience here, just awful. And so we try to keep, doing something to keep from getting bored, fight off the boredom. Stay active, play cards, you name it, watch television. And we think, if I just, die, then it's all gone. And what I discovered is that that's absolutely not true. It's a total lie. All our troubles stay with us. And we continue to experience them, and we come back here and get born again as a baby, go through childhood, all this hellish stuff that we go through in life. We do it over again and over and over. As long as we believe the ego's lies, we will continue to be reborn. That's it. I saw this. I experienced it. There's no question about it. And so I would say that for me, the fact of reincarnation is tremendous leverage over the ego. For me, it's the best. It's the best. What could be more terrible than realizing that you're coming back here indefinitely until you're enlightened, and there's no other way out of it? I mean, that's just the most hideous thing ever. So I've never slowed down since that moment. Never taken a day off. But it gave me this leverage, and I just said, "Ego, you're a liar." I began to see all its lies. It does nothing but lie, and delay, contend, slow our momentum down, break up our familiarity, you know, get us to lose it. It just contends with truth, and I just say, "No, you're not controlling my mind. I'm not going to give you that leverage over me anymore. I've got the leverage over you now." The ego hides reincarnation. It doesn't want us to know about it as much as possible. Its ace in the hole is, it says, when you die, everything's fine. That's the big lie it tells us. We may not feel quite as awful as we do now, but when does the tsunami start? When it hits the beach, or when the earthquake starts? It's when the earthquake hits. That's when the tsunami really, you know, starts, right? And so, when we die, that's like an earthquake that is pushing us towards our next birth. It's pushing us towards our next birth. We have to be liberated from death. So Jesus came to liberate us from death and bring us into eternal life. Because I'll tell you this, that life that we have here is fake life. Fake life. You've probably never heard that term before. And the death is fake death. How can there be a real death of fake life? Consider that. There can't be, can there? It's fake life, fake death. These bodies have nothing to do with what we are. It's just we're faking life in order to kill fake life and claim that we killed real life. That's all we're really doing. And until we give that up, we will continue to play this game of fake life so there can be fake death. It's all a game of sacrifice to try to get rid of our fear of being, because we're imagining that we're the creators of non-being. And we say, well, that's all good and well, but I keep being attracted to something that seems like it's threatening non-being. Well, yeah, it's called our being. That's what we're attracted to. It's like we're dreaming some dream, and we say, oh my gosh, this is horrible. I feel something's threatening. I feel so threatened in the dream, and you're going doing all this stuff to like avoid this threat, and you symbolize the threat in the dream as these bodies are coming after you and trying to get you and kill you, and it's terrible. But what you're really being threatened by in the dream is your desire to awaken from the dream. But we don't admit that in the dream. We can't admit it. We say no. And so we imagine these, you know, these monsters coming after us, actually. And so what we've done is we've imagined bodies and worlds and death to try to get rid of these monsters. But it's really just our desire to awaken that is scaring us. Because we say, well, you know, I'm the new prime creator, and without a creation, non-being, my creation of non-being, I won't be a prime creator, so I won't be anything. You see? So we're afraid of like an abyss of annihilation. But the truth is, we're not a new prime creator. We're a co-creator with God. So when we wake up from the dream, we'll just realize, oh, I'm still a co-creator with God. Everything's fine. It's great. It's perfect. So you see, if the creator loses his creation, then there's no creator, right? we think we're going to lose our identity as this creator of non-being, of nothing, nothingness, when we wake up from the dream. So again, we feel threatened by reality. Our attraction to reality, to beingness, threatens what we think our identity. So we project this threat. It's just amorphous threat. We don't know, you know, it just seems everywhere. We don't know where it is. So we imagine form and fixate that it's here and it's here, that space, time and space, it's here, it's here, it's here. And it's going through these processes that gradually cause it to disintegrate and die. Bodies. These bodies have nothing to do with what we are. And when we can finally get that perspective, oh, what a happy day that will be. And the world has nothing to do with what we are. Nothing to do whatsoever. And you think this is difficult. Well, it is difficult to get this perspective. Sure it is. I'm still working on it. And it's getting closer and closer and closer. And I'm getting little glimpses of feeling, oh, you know, yeah, that's great. But I would say the key is to realize that we believe that we're a new prime creator. Okay, with separate from God, and our creation is non-being. Because we can't create being because that's God's creation. So in order to say that we're separate from God, different, the only other option is non-being, which is nothing at all. it's just we just imagine that it's something it isn't. No such thing as non-being. And so we think that without, if we wake up, that means that non-being will realize, oh, there is no non-being. And then we think, oh, I won't, that means I'm not a prime creator, it means I'm nothing. We think we've separated from being spirit, the Son of God, and are no longer that, but we're actually now a new prime creator, and that we've, you know, cut the cord, we're not spirit anymore. But this isn't true. We're just spirit dreaming is all. That's it. So what do you do when you see this? The repentant mind says, well, I've got leverage now. I've got more leverage now. And you say, okay, full stop in the wow. You say, wow, that's great. I've already seen it. Now, the ego will try to contend with you and say, well, what did you see what? don't get into that. You know, the ego says, well, what did you see? You got leverage over me? Oh, okay, great. Oh, what is the leverage? See, don't follow that. Full stop in the wow means you're not explaining anything to the ego. You're not explaining anything to anyone. Just no explanation. You already did it. So we already saw this in the video. We saw something extraordinarily key. Extraordinarily key. And I can tell. I know. I'm like, wow. I never saw that before. So when you see something you never saw before, and it's, you know, it's very significant, for sure, there's a wow coming to that. And so you don't wait until you're panicking to full stop in the wow. This is the whole key. You don't, when if you panic, then you're looking for help, and then the ego says, hey, you know, I'm a friend, you can talk with me, and you know, what did you do? And before you know, you're into words and explanations and understanding. Is there anything that can stand under beingness, allness, everywhere it is, intrinsic, spacious? Where is there an under to that? So how can you stand under it and have a perspective and viewpoint and say, oh yeah, I'm standing under this and now I see. There is no such thing as understanding. Understanding comes from the really word, it's to stand under, like a bridge. I'm standing under the bridge, I'm looking, oh, okay, now I can see that. Or standing under the tree, understanding. There's no standing under isness, everywhereness, beingness, awareness, freedom. How can you stand under freedom, perfect freedom? Where could you be to stand under that? You can't. You cannot. So the ego will play this game of being your friend, but we don't allow that. We just full stop in the wow. Said, not now, ego. Maybe later. Ego says, you know, I don't want to talk about it. I can help you. Now I'm doing the full stop in the wow. So, only those who have leverage over the ego can do this full stop in the wow, who have repentant mind. If you can do this full stop in the wow, that means you do have leverage. It really does, because you could just push the ego aside But the ego is a ferocious opponent. And this practice, getting good at this practice, has been something that I've been worked on a long time. The ego just is so tricky. This is why we say full stop Don't. There's no wiggle room there, is there? But it's more like we're just coasting. We've stopped accelerating, full stop of acceleration. We're just not engaged with that aspect anymore. We're just allowing the momentum that we have now to take us forward and trusting in it, having faith in God and in the path and in the grace of God. Full stop in the wow is the grace of God, because we're saying, okay, I saw what's so important. I saw something very important. I know that I saw it. I'm not going to second guess myself. Now I'm just going to allow that to take me wherever it's taking me. That's it. So it's now taken us. We don't have to do the accelerating, okay? We made the effort to get to that insight, that clarity, and now let that clarity take us wherever it's taking us. And we're just a passenger now. We're just a quiet passenger. And we're not speculating on anything, where it's taking us or anything like that. We just have faith at this point. Have faith. Faith comes from the grace of God. It comes from leverage over the ego. So there may be many ways to get leverage over the ego, really. But I found reincarnation for me was absolutely it. Because I said, wow, I caught the ego in just a total extreme lie. I said, hey, ego. How come you didn't tell me about these past lives? You said that my last life, that was the finish. That was it. I did all this great work. You said, okay, you know, you're done. You're done. You go to heaven and that's it. And I can see that I've come back again and again and again and again and again and again. 33rd time, as far as I could tell. You never explained any of this to me. You didn't explain how is that possible. And I realized I had the same troubles as I had last life. Exact same troubles. Everything's, you know, I carried it all with me. Like on my back, a tortoise carrying their shell. It's like a personality. It's like a shell that we carry with us. The death of the body doesn't destroy the mental shell of belief. We carry the shell of belief with us into the next body identification, next sacrificial offering. Trying to get rid of this fear. And you gave me no insight to it, ego, last life at all. You just promised me I wouldn't return if I did, you know, if I did whatever I did. And that's a lie. And at that point, the ego realized it was busted. And the ego realized I had leverage over it now. And so that's when it went ballistic on me and tried to just, you know, project its own, what do you call, futility upon me, because the ego realized it's all over for it. It's finished. Once you get the leverage like this, it's the ego's as good as done. And stick a fork in it. It's done. And so it was just absolutely projecting all its own misery and futility and fear and insignificance and stupidity and everything that, you know, this contending against truth is just futile. It projected it all on me and said I was just totally incompetent and a complete idiot. I would never amount to anything, and on and on. Well, it was really talking about itself. Of course, contending against truth is, you know, it gets nowhere. It's a losing game. But the ego is really just an expression of our continuity fear. We talk as if it's something separate from us. Of course, it's not. It's just in the service of contending against truth and contending for us being prime creator of non-being. So the ego's basically telling me, you know, you're a failure as a prime creator. You're absolute failure. I should have said, yeah, I know, absolutely, thank you. But I'm a perfect failure. I kept my perfection. So yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I absolutely failed to be prime creator. Thank God for that. But I didn't have the wisdom at that time point. So the ego really was just blasting me. And I said, "Help, Holy Spirit! I'm going to just lose all sense of confidence completely if I don't have help." And the Holy Spirit immediately stepped in and said, "Don't worry, don't worry. You got the leverage now. Everything will be fine, and I'll be with you, take you all the way through to perfect freedom again. And it's a done deal." The Holy Spirit said, is absolutely confident about it. So the Holy Spirit's confidence stepped in to support my confidence, which was almost gone, vanished, on a ver dwindled down to virtually nothing. I really was in a state of zero confidence, realizing that the ego as an advisor is a complete liar and I can't rely upon it at all. And I said, "What do I do?" It's like, and the ego's then just absolutely furious with me. And I realized that the relationship is ruptured, irreparably ruptured. So I thought, I'm just doomed. And the Holy Spirit stepped in with its confidence and said, with perfect confidence, and said, "No worries, no troubles. We've got it. We've already got it. We're going to do it. And that's all there is to it." And I was like, "Oh, wow." And I gradually started recovering and making my way away from that devastation of seeing that the ego is nothing but a deceiver and a liar. Because we've been relying upon it, saying, "When you die, that's it, and that's our salvation, that's the solution." And when I found out that's not the solution, I didn't have a solution. I was like without any solution whatsoever. I said, "What do I do? I have no idea what to do." That's when the Holy Spirit stepped in and said, "Well, I know exactly what to do." And so we will walk the walk. We will walk the walk together. We will walk together, and walk together in the wow. And that's what we've been doing, walking together in the wow. As I see more and more and more and more and more, oh, that's it. Oh, that's it. Okay. So today's been a great day of great insight, tremendously intelligent and clear wisdom and insight. It's been extraordinary. I see the trouble people have. They don't have leverage. If you don't have leverage, you spin your wheels. You just wander aimlessly. Nothing I can do. I mean, the Holy Spirit can subtly somehow move them towards leverage, but I don't really see myself. I haven't been able to help anyone who hasn't repented. If you haven't repented, you just think you're being attacked, because basically you hear that your advisor, which and death, which you're counting upon as your salvation, doesn't work, and your advisor's crazy and is a liar, and you feel you're being attacked. You feel you're being attacked. And of course, the ego uses its leverage over you to make you feel that way. It's so leverage is all important. All important. And once I got that leverage, I began to pay attention. The Holy Spirit would say, "Pay attention to the over here." And I'd say, "Huh? Why?" "Okay, I'll try." I looked over there and I saw something like, "Oh my gosh, if I hadn't have shifted my attention, I wouldn't have seen that, and that's very helpful." I said, "Well, why was my attention over here?" "Oh, that's what the ego wanted me to have." Oh, so it was this play of attention, of gradually getting my attention away from the ego, like that. So I could put my attention on the big picture. And the big picture is getting bigger and bigger and bigger now for me. And this is the path for everyone. Once you get that leverage, once you repent, the ego's finished, and it's just a matter of you working on your familiarity, which is best done every day. That's the best way to do it. Unlike like exercise, exercise, and I take a couple of days off because you let your body recover. But on the spiritual path, don't take a day off. You will find that the familiarity will suffer if you do. Don't take a day off. Always be doing something. We're always trying to do something to keep me engaged, whether it's these videos is helping me, stay engaged with this. I'm always working on some video. I'm always working on some graphics. I'm always working on trying to make available to others something that will help them. And always trying to deepen my understanding so I can be more helpful. It's constant. It's constant. But today I saw, wow, you really can't help those who haven't repented. I see what's going to come in the world too. I saw today, the Holy Spirit directed my attention to something also. What's happening? It's amazing what's happening, and the Holy Spirit's waking me up to it. I met somebody today, and just a, you know, just a fellow peasant, so to speak, you know. But I try to treat everybody like they have something really important to tell me. I don't care what it is, who it is. My focus is that whatever this person has, something really important, is they're going to help me. They're going to help me. And I keep meeting people, and they keep helping me, telling me what I should do without even asking. They just out of their mouths comes this information, you know. And he said, hey, have you heard of, you know, here in California, you call it Section 8 of housing thing, where they have to have this affordable housing and all the new stuff, and they have to, whatever, it's part of the mandate. So it's subsidized housing. And so you get, he said, you get these people, and a lot of them are, he said, crackheads. Say, so, you know, let's call it what it is. They live in the same place where these people are paying $3,000-$4,000 a month in rent. I mean, it's ridiculous, the rents here. And then he said, you know, pretty soon you only have millionaires and crackheads. You know, I actually came with that line. You know, millionaires and crackheads. That's it. And he said the middle class is they're wiping it out. And I said, yes, absolutely true. It's gone from like 60% here in the Santa Clara County to about, I think, 9% or something like that of middle class. We're being destroyed. We're being destroyed. Because we can't qualify for subsidized housing, and we can't afford the rents. I mean, we can't afford to live. Either subsidized or you're a millionaire. That's it. That's it. And this is what's happening all over the world, actually. And what is happening, really, spiritually, is this idea that there's a middle place. Like, let me ask this question. Let's say there's two different directions, opposite directions. One's going towards the lowest common denominator, other's going to the highest common denominator. Is there a middle direction? Is there a middle direction in those two directions? Is there some middle direction? And we think there is, and this is a complete delusion on our part, that there's some middle direction. Are there some middle place between truth and lies, that it's not a truth and it's not lie, it's some, there isn't any such middle place. There is no middle to reality at all. So to say that there's a middle is a lie. There's some middle direction. Really? You're walking down the street this way, and you turn around, you go back the other way, and you say, oh, well, I need to abide in this middle direction. Where's the middle direction? Aimless wandering, you know? Yeah, I mean, aimless wandering. So we have been under this terrible delusion that there's some middle place, some fence to sit on. There isn't any fence to sit on, actually, between truth and lies. And this is collapsing, because we thought that we could find a place, excuse me, and the attraction to reality, to awaking from the dream, would cease. We thought so we think, well, we're being attracted away from lies and attracted towards truth, but we don't want to wake up, so let's, oh, there's a middle place between truth and lies where that, you know, the attraction can rest on that, and that's what we're attracted to. Guess what? It didn't work. It didn't work. And what's happening is we're realizing that doesn't work. We're still being attracted to waking up, which terrifies us. So what we're doing now is, what's happening in the world is, now we're realizing there are just two directions, not three, just two. You're either going towards the lowest common denominator or the highest common denominator. That's it. You're either desperately trying to get away from waking up by going to this lowest common denominator and staying. That'll keep people really busy controlling everyone else, you know, controlling one another, and dumbing everybody down. And it's basically global communism. Or you're attracted towards awakening and saying, okay, I can't escape it. I might as well face the spiritual path and work on awakening, highest common denominator. So the whole world is being divided into this, you know, the highest common denominator, the lowest common denominator. And if they're going to the lowest common denominator, there are those who are desperate to be the ones who are controlling, right, the power. So they can make sure that doesn't get away from them. The millionaires, all right, the people are going after the power. Now, this trend towards lowest common denominator, Sri Sri showed me something. She's the way she works is so amazing that I can't explain it to anyone. I've tried and I failed. It's impossible. Just almost too effective, really, too amazing. I can get it. I tried to share it. I couldn't share it, and so I just it's frustrating. But what she is able to point out is that this what I what she depicted was what very clearly was this yoga girl communism is coming. It's amazing how she depicted it. Yoga girl communism. It's not the red communism that we think, that was back in the Cultural Revolution of the 70s. It's yoga girl communism is what's actually coming. And the sages with the sage within you gets what's being pointed out here, gets it, right? Yeah, this is what's actually coming. This is what's actually going to take place here. People call it the nanny state, big mother, lots of different terms. But yoga girl communism, I really like that term. You can use it. Use it. It's helpful. It gives you leverage over those in a situation. Yoga girl communism. It's coming, and it's terrible. It's going to push everyone down to the lowest common denominator. This is what communism is. It says, let's all get on the same page. But how do we do that? Lower everyone down. Get rid of God. Even a absurd God. Even fake abstraction is better than no abstraction at all. When we have this absolute relativism, you're trapped. People here are screaming, "We're trapped! We're trapped! We're trapped!" I heard them when I was not in a non-incarnated state, and so I said, "Wow, I got to help out. Let me see what I can do. I know I'm coming back here, so let me use my life to try and help them out get free of entrapment." And I hadn't been able to see what the entrapment is, so I thought maybe they're not. But what they're trapped in is relativism. If you get rid of absolutism, then you're in relativism, and that indeed is a trap. Relativism is a trap. You can't get out of it at the level of relativism. You can't apply relativism to get free of relativism. It's impossible. So you have to have an absolute in order to get out of relativism. You have to. Otherwise, you're just spinning your wheels and will spin your wheels forever. So what we did is we imagined an abstraction, God. But a fake God, the God that most of us are focusing on is a fake God, fake abstraction. It's not real abstraction. It's not the real abstraction of God at all. But it at least it gives us some traction in relation to relativism, where there's no right or wrong. You can't say, well, there's no absolutes at all. There are no in relativism. There's no absolutes. Which what do people do then? Power. Money, greed, they go after control. And a communist is going to have to, it's all about control. They're atheists. They're relativists. They don't believe in any in absolutism at all. The state is the absolute. Yeah, right? Control is that the absolute. The bureaucratic machinery, the bureaucratic monster is the absolute, which keeps relativism in place, and people just become like these economic animals, basically. It's hard. It's trying to fight off boredom. Really, relativism leads to this hideous boredom. Ah, oh, it's the worst. So we came up with an abstraction now of God in our own paranoid image. We might say we made God in our own image. This, we hear church says God made man and humanity in their own in its own image. But what we really did, we made this fake abstraction in our own image of paranoia, of fear of awakening from this dream. But let us not go back into relativism by recognizing that, because it's a step in the right direction. At least we're recognizing that we need some absolute, right, to get out of this trap of relativism. But it's a crumb. It's just a little crumb. What we need is the whole pie. And we think it's the whole pie is too much. You see, it scares us. There is a real God. There is a real absolute. Just because we make a fake something doesn't mean the real one doesn't exist. This is another ridiculous notion, that absurdist notion that the ego tries to promulgate, is that if we make something fake, then the real one doesn't exist. It's like you get these clever Brits making fake crop circles, you know, and they say, aha, you see, yes, we admit to this scam. We made this fake crop circle, but we're just pointing out how gullible you people are. And they want you to believe that just because they faked a clumsy crop circle, that the other ones therefore must also be fake. I mean, what kind of stupidity is that? It's absurdity, isn't it? It's egoic absurdity. And so, let us not get caught up in that. But we're afraid of caught between, well, like if I give up this crumb of abstraction, absolutism, I might not have any, you know. Oh, or I might have too much. It's like, oh, that's too much. I'm sort of copied. It's either too much or none. So we kind of stick with the crumb. So people in church are going to church, they're sticking with the crumb. And when you go to Mass last Sunday, it's a crumb. It's a little crumb. They're grabbing all. It's sacrificial. The whole service was all about sacrificial atonement, appeasing an angry God and reconciling us to God. Otherwise, without this sacrifice, you know, blood sacrifice, that there's no way we can be reconciled to God. You know, it's all about that, which is just this completely fake God, fake absolutism, fake abstraction. Doesn't have anything to do with God at all. But it's better than just total relativism. Okay, it's a crumb. It gives a little bit of tiny crumb of peace of mind. You know, just other than the hell of relativism. But when you talk to those people, religious people, and tell them what God's really about, they're like, oh, that's too much peace. I can't handle that. That's too much peace. No, 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 no. What are you doing? You're trying to get me to get rid of that crumb. It's like a dog, you know. You give the dog a little crumb, and then you got this big, you know, like a little bone, and you got the big bone. The dog's like, how do I hold on to this little bone and still grab hold of the big one? And it's like, it's got this dilemma, you know, the dog's dilemma. I don't want to drop this one because I got it in my mouth, but I need to open my mouth in order to grab the big bone. If I open my mouth, the other one's going to drop out. And the dog just gets in this quandary, like starts whining, like, oh, you know, what do I do? We're like that. We're like the dog's dilemma. We have the dog's dilemma. We think if we go to grab the pie, you know, we'll drop the crumb, and we say, oh, I don't have the crumb anymore. That's the dilemma. We're in this dilemma, actually. So we need to go from this fake abstraction to true abstraction, fake absolutism to true absolutism, fake God to real God. But it's better to have a fake God than no God at all. All right, so I'm not trying to take a fake God away from anybody. You keep a hold of it. Okay, that's fine. What you do is start getting familiar with the real God. And ultimately, you'll be less and less and less concerned about that fake God. But it's like a security blanket. So we're not trying to throw the security blanket away. Not at all. Like I said, I still go to Mass, even though it's getting very difficult because it's so much nonsense. It's just like, oh my gosh. Yeah. Wow. Sacrifice. God's got to die in order to reconcile it. It's absurd. It's nonsense. It's paranoia. It's a religion of paranoia. But it's better than relativism. So I'm supportive of it in the context of it's at least a step in the right direction. Realizing you do need absolutism. You do. Or else you're just headed for the bottom. And so this world is trying to get rid of absolutism. And supplant it with what? Numbers, algorithms, artificial intelligence. Which is really just this massive bureaucracy coming at us. And that's supposed to supplant absolutism and abstraction. God, really? What's going to happen is that for a while it will seem to work. Okay, this is the big perspective I'm able to have now. Because we'll be so occupied and busy and of controlling everybody and getting everybody down to the lowest common denominator and thinking that, hey, we're succeeding, we're going towards our goal, we're getting going, you know, doing great at this, that we'll for a while we'll be so engaged in this that we, you know, it won't hit us what's really going on. So this path starts out full of hope, but it's false hope, very false hope. This totalitarian system that is coming, people won't see it at first. They won't see it. They think this is great. I feel so much better now. I'm so busy. There's no boredom. I've got to bust everybody's head in the world, you know. I've got to put everybody in chains. And it's a lot of work. A lot of technology involved, right? A lot of infrastructure involved. And so everybody feels they're part of this great movement. You know, yoga girl communism is going to be like the greatest thing ever. So it won't be like people are like saying, oh, this is horrible. They say, oh, thank you, yoga girl communism. This is wonderful. It's a better brand of communism. You know, we were worried it might be that rougher type, you know, the mid-war, of course, in the Cultural Revolution, the women were terrible. Really. But they say, well, this is a nicer yoga girl communism. It's not nearly as bad as I thought it'd be. In fact, it's actually very interesting. And how do we regulate and control everybody, including their thoughts and their all their actions and how many breaths they take, and how do we legislate everything? And wow, what a big task, what a challenge. And so they dive into it, and they're just so preoccupied with it. It fends off the darkness. They're walking into darkness, but they're so preoccupied they don't realize they're going into a dead end, a terrible dead end. And at some point the boredom and everything will hit them so terrible, so awful. But not initially. So there's nothing you could say to them. They think that's cause celeb, you know, this is it. They finally found the philosopher's stone. Yoga girl communism is the answer. This is what's happening here. And this idea that there's some ideal middle ground where our attraction to awakening evaporates is simply not true at all. And we realize it's not true. It didn't work. Didn't work. And so that's evaporating. The middle class thing is evaporating. It's evaporating. It really is super fast. Super fast. Now you don't, the middle class is just amazing what's happening. And it will be accelerated. The Holy Spirit pointed out something to me that the debt crisis is going to hit at some point, right? They'll try to print their way out of it with more money, but at some point, something is going to happen, and people will lose their shirts. And it's just what is coming is. But it's a crisis that the yoga girl communism will use to seize power, and that'll be it. The whole globe will be changed, and we will. People think that they're going into this great green revolution, and finally we got, you know, the right direction and all this kind of stuff. But completely ignoring the devastating dynamics of relativism, and the feeling of absolute entrapment with no way to get out of it. Foolish, very, very foolish. So no one's ever heard me say get rid of God. Okay, I'm pointing out how to get the real God, you know, get in tune with that. But I'm a big champion of religion, even though I point out his mistakes. You don't take that away from people, because the alternative is this relativism, which yoga girl communism is trying to put a sweet face to it, okay? But it is terrible. And you will rue the day that you ever went in that direction, and whoever did. But what can I do? I can only help those who have repented. Otherwise, it's in one ear, not the other. And they think they're being attacked. Pretty frustrating. What we need to do, focus on what's coming, is the beautiful mind that we really have. We have this beautiful mind, and the great Dharma kings and queens have shown us how beautiful our mind is. Their mind is our mind too. It's all one mind. And they're showing us how beautiful our mind is, and we need to be reminded of how beautiful our mind really is, how absolutely wonderful it actually is. The mind of Jesus is the same mind that we have. We're just pretending that we're no longer that mind, that we're now a new prime creator. So we're denying that we have this mind, but we haven't left our mind at all. And so we still have this beautiful mind within us. It's just absolutely wonderful. Sometimes I just, before I go to sleep, I lie down and I just sort of start imagining beauty, and the mind just starts taking over, and it just presents this endless vistas of creative beauty that is, you know, it's just instantly changeable and instantly, and it's just endlessly creative, effortlessly. It's so entertaining, you can't believe it. And you cannot capture it in graphics because it's all free. It's all, you're never stuck in any vista. You could be seeing infinite vistas of creative beauty forever, looking out, and it goes on forever, and then instantly it all changes into something else beautifully creative. It's never, you're never fixated. There's no fixation graphically or experientially at all. You feel this, just this freedom. Whereas, so any art, there's fixation, right? So you can never reflect properly the experiencing of mind. It's impossible. Image wise, it's impossible. So we understand that, you know, you damn it with faint praise. I still do beautiful graphics. I try to at least remind you that the mind is beautiful. It's very important. The beautiful mind of Jesus, the beautiful mind of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, or Sri Sri Anandamayi, as I like to say it. The beautiful mind of Ramana Maharshi, the beautiful mind of Longchenpa. These are showcases to us of how beautiful our mind is. So what we need to do is, there's going to be so many ugly pictures of our mind coming up in the world, so much ugliness coming up. Don't pay attention to it. Pay attention to how beautiful our mind is. This is so key, and this is all I've tried to do in my life, is put beauty in front of people and say, look, just stay in touch with how beautiful our mind is. Don't pay attention to the ugliness. It's not true. It's fake. That's not true mind. It's fake mind. It's like a mirror that we painted ugliness on a mirror, and they're holding up to the mind saying, look, you see, mind, that's what you are. We have this image and they're holding up to mind saying, that's not what, the mind cannot be reflected. That's how beautiful, that's how free our mind is. Our mind is completely beautiful. It just is beauty itself. It's just is beauty. Our mind is beauty. That's how it's able to then just put all this beauty out, endless waves and vistas of beauty and experiencing of beauty, and never trouble to change any of it at an instant's notice. Flick of a switch, it's all changed if we wanted to. That's our mind. That is our mind. It's the same mind that Jesus has, which is why he's able to speak so beautifully to us. Same mind as Longchenpa, which is why he's able to speak so beautifully to us. Same mind as Sri Sri Anandamayi, which is why she's able to speak so beautifully to us. Same mind as Ramana Maharshi, which is why he's able to witness so beautifully to us. It's the same mind. We all have that same mind. And therefore, we don't need to try to reflect mind to people as a remedy. I don't do it as a remedy. I do it as a reminder. There's a big difference. So the repentant mind that's repented understands this is just a reminder pointing to mind. It's not attempting to say this is the mind. Never. It's impossible. You cannot reflect the mind. How can we reflect freedom? It's impossible, isn't it? Reflecting freedom? How do you do that? Perfect freedom? That's completely ineffable. The nature of our mind is complete ineffability, ineffableness, ineffinescence, complete ineffinescence. There's a great word, a new word, ineffinescence. The nature of our mind is perfect ineffinescence. Hey, I love that word. It's a brand new word. I often coin new words. Why not? Ineffinescence, a combination of ineffable and evanescence, evanescent. Ineffinescence. Use it if you want to. No charge. You know, it's free. It's perfect ineffinescence. How do you reflect perfect ineffinescence? It's freedom. Is ineffinescence, isn't it? Absolutely, it is. So obviously, they were just crude reminders. I know it's crude reminders, they're all crude, but it's better than no reminders at all. especially in a time where everybody is trying to say the mind, look how ugly it is. This is the media, television, they're constantly saying, look how ugly we are. Isn't this awful? All of those are lies. Complete, total lies. Has nothing to do with what we are. Why? So why spend time with lies? What does that get us? Well, only relativism does that. It thinks that it can get some contrast. You know, it's like, well, I'm stuck because I don't have any absolutes, so there's no, I need some authority to tell me, well, you know, I'm supposed to watch this, okay. You become like a zombie. And then these controllers control you. Relativism is, oh, of course they're trying to get rid of God. The first thing communists did was get rid of God. They went into Tibet. First thing they did is destroy all the monasteries, all the icons, all the books, the lamas, the monks, the Rinpoches, the Tulkus, whatever they... Get rid of religion. Get rid... That's the first thing communists do. Get rid of religion, which means get rid of any absolute. Because then they can enslave everybody because everyone's stuck, trapped in relativism. And they don't know what to do. So they have to be told what to do. They have to be told what to do by the oligarchy, the Politburo, right? The Communist Party, the bureaucracy. They then control everyone, which makes them feel safe from awakening, right? Because they can get all the, tell all these people, say, oh, I'm starting to awaken, you have to do this, and this will keep me from sleeping. Our fear is awakening to what we are, not realizing that that's it's okay, because we didn't separate. We think when we awaken, we'll say, oh, there, nothing is really non-existent, and I didn't create anything. That means I'm not a prime creator. It means I'm nothing. No, it means that we're spirit, that we're just dreaming that we're a prime creator. And we're still completely co-creators with God. So I'm having rough nights. I wake up 2 in the morning, 4 in the morning, nightmares, just lots of stuff that's like, oh my gosh, you know, this is, it's very stressful. April started, has turned out to be very stressful. Wow. At the same time, great progress too, but I'm kind of shaky and trembling. My nerves are really under siege right now. Yoga Girl Communism is on its way here. If that doesn't put a chill down your spine, I don't know what does. That's worse than Red Chinese Communism, actually. It's worse. They were just paranoid and vicious. Yoga Girl Communism is like Nurse Ratched. Isn't it wonderful you can get to take these meds? Aren't we taking great care of you? Isn't this absolutely wonderful? Can we do some stretching now? And you know, they play like the mother thing of like, aren't you so fortunate? Isn't this wonderful? You know, and it's like you're in the zombie land of relativism. And you feel like you're just paralyzed, like the spider has got you. Spider's wearing a dress now. And the lowest, this is how we go to lowest common denominator, which is mother. Okay, when we're really stressed out and we feel helpless, what do we say? How do we relate to that? Where's mom? Where's mother? You know, right? So of course they're using this, in order to lower us all down to the lowest common denominator, they're using the mother symbol, mother image. The sweet mother, your child, young mother, your baby, you know, she's 25, 30 or something, and she's the yoga girl, and you're this little helpless child who just says relativism, doesn't know anything about God or absolute, doesn't, and she is your absolute, and she'll take care of you as long as you do what she tells you to do. And if you don't, I forgot my child. Where is my child? You know, or go to your room, or you don't get any dinner or anything like that. So the lowest common denominator is our relationship with mother. When helpless babies, that's going down to the lowest common denominator, which is why I've been saying we're headed towards this terrible global matriarchy, which is Yoga Girl Communism. Whereas the highest common denominator is God. The absolute, total abstraction, where we wake up and realize we're mind, this glorious, beautiful mind. We're not this little baby that's just a fake life. We're not fake life. The mind doesn't need fake life. What does the mind need fake life for? It is life. So, this is it. This is where we're at. And will there be a bank crisis? Holy Spirit seems to indicate yes. Peter Schiff, the one who's all over the internet now, saying, I wrote this book about the subprime mortgage, meltdown. All this meltdowns that happened before it happened. I saw it. I'll take his word for it that he saw it before it happened, and he wrote a book, etc. You can see these things before they happen. For sure, you can. You can see this hardening of attitudes that's coming. You know, which direction you're going toward. You're going towards lowest common denominator, highest. These two attitudes are going to part ways. Absolutely, there's no more middle ground than ever was. It was an illusion. And what they're saying is, oh, okay, everybody has to go to lowest common denominator. No. We're going to highest common denominator, which is God, which is mind, which is spirit. And so you can see this coming ahead of time if you have a big view. Now, some financial people can see these crashes coming. They can't. It's a lot more difficult to see this meltdown, global meltdown, yoga girl communism coming. That's a much bigger issue. But it's possible to see it coming. It certainly is. Holy Spirit's been showing me this is what's coming. So, but we're also likely to get a financial crisis too. Very likely. Very likely. Maybe soon. Maybe some subprime mortgage thing happened quickly, did it not? These things happen fast. They really do happen fast. At some point, he says the government will say, we're insolvent. We can't keep going. We're insolvent. Martial law. No more election, right? I mean, on and on and on. Or just, nasty stuff is coming. And so this is the feeling that people have, like, wow, I can't give away names and indicate too much. But let me just say that I had quite an extraordinary experience today. Where I would say, let us say, that I became aware that the elites are definitely taking emergency measures now to hide away underground. Okay, I'm aware, very aware of this now. I've been saying this for a long time. Okay, but now I really know this is actually literally happening, and they're in panic mode right now. And they plan to hide away underground while the meltdown happens. And again, I'm not going to try to identify anyone or any situation here, but I'm telling you, literally, I'm directly aware of this now. They are doing this, folks. Okay, this is not speculation. I'm 100% aware for sure. They are going to go underground. Okay? Literally, this is what's going to happen. The ultra-rich, they know something's coming now, very soon. And they're scurrying as fast as possible to secure underground locations. And you won't know where they are. They will just simply disappear. They will simply disappear. And you'll have no clue where they are. They're going underground. Believe it. This is now, I've had absolute direct confirmation of this now. I wasn't looking for it. It just happened. I was just like, whoa, this is amazing. Holy cow. They have the money to do it. They have the money to do it. And they've either done it or are doing it. Yeah. The technology's been there for quite some time. And it's pretty clever, isn't it? They have secret entrances. They go underground, and they live underground until the troubles here on the surface have the storm has subsided, and then they'll reappear and take control of stuff in their way, But this is literally what's happening now, and they're in such a rush that you'd have to say it's coming very soon. Very soon, they know what's coming. That these people are really connected. These ultra rich people, they're aware that there's some sort of meltdown taking place, global meltdown, financial meltdown. And so they're making now final preparations to go underground. Whereas we're making preparations, what? Reduced intensity zone. How's my golf swing? Great. Right? Take a golf, extended golf vacation, really. The Phoenix plan, you know, Phoenix, Arizona, a reduced intensity zone, Phoenix, or rising from the ashes, kind of, so to speak. We rise up from the ashes of this world, you know, to safety. Highest common denominatorville is where we're headed, whereas the elites are headed underground here on this world. They can't get into the reduced intensity zone because they haven't prepared properly. They don't have the leverage. The ego's still in control. You need to repent. As Jesus said, you can't get in the kingdom of heaven unless you repent. This is very true. And repentance is leverage. It means leverage over the ego. You have to get that leverage to recognize that this is all fake life. It's just all fake. It's a sacrificial, death-based dream. Fear-based, sacrifice-based, death-based, trying to kill God, which it feels is threatening our prime creatorship by attracting us back to awakening from the dream. It's pretty simple. I want you to see it. So I've got a swing with the driver now that's like repeatable, which is like the Holy Grail, you know, the Holy Grail, really. It's just amazing. I didn't focus on it before. My buddy Bubba Watson gave a tip. And he said, if you don't know Bubba Watson, he's a two-time Masters champion. And I had a little chat with him once. He didn't give me the tip that he did it online and in a video, but I call him my buddy Bubba. He's a very talented golfer. He's a great golfer, actually. And he hits the ball farther than anybody, consistently far. And he said, they asked him, Bubba, how do you hit the driver so far? What's the key? And he said, look, I'll tell you the truth. And he gave one of the best lessons I've ever heard. He said, look, stop worrying about hitting it so far and swing slower. I'm like, what? He says, yeah, swing slower and concentrate on hitting the sweet spot of your club. Concentrate on that. I know I probably said this in the last video, bears repeating. He says, swing slower to hit it farther. He says, well, what I do, I'm so talented and practice so much, I'm able to hit it on the sweet spot, even though I swing real hard and almost every time. He said, but this is a really advanced skill. He says, for you, you got to practice hitting the sweet spot. And he focuses, most players, they do not hit it on that, which is true. They don't hit the sweet spot at all. I almost rarely do. Occasionally I do, and I say, oh, that's it. And then I think I've got it. And then next swing, I hit it on the toe, and it's terrible. So I finally found a way to control the club head so it's the exact same distance from my body every swing, which means that I can dial in the sweet spot pretty much. It also has to be pretty high up on the club face, so I have to, you know, work on dialing that in too. That's easier. So that's like very, very good. Very, very good. You slow down to hit the sweet spot. This is the same thing with God. You slow down your search to find God. We're looking for God, and that's why we're not finding God, because God's everywhere. To look for God means we're implying that God is someplace other than everywhere. And so we're trying to find God. That's the whole problem. Trying to find God is the problem. It's when we stop searching for God that we find God, because God's everywhere. It's the search that is the problem, actually. And this is what the great teachers have told us, right? Call off the search. That was one of Puntiji's aphorisms, call off the search. That's right. You stop the search and there's God. God's already here. It's just looking for God, we're denying that God is everywhere. Otherwise, looking would be complete absurdity, right? And it is a complete absurdity, and yet we don't see that. We think, no, I'm looking, I can't, I don't know where God is, so of course I got to keep looking. What are you talking about? Stopping, that's crazy. No, it's not crazy. Because to say that we're looking for God automatically implies God is something other than allness, right? That's absolutely what it's saying. Because if God was allness, we couldn't possibly need to search for God, right? So any search for God is a direct statement that God is not everywhere. Absolutely it is. So the key to finding God is to stop looking for God. Yeah, slow down. Like Bubba said, slow down to hit it farther. Slow down to find God. Slow down to find God. Have we hit the? Yeah, we've got the one hour. Yeah, great. I've enjoyed making this video. I'm really tired, but I've been able to bring it. You know, I've got the juice. That's amazing. I thought I wouldn't be able to do it, but I'm so into this. It's so important that I'm able to bring it. But at some point, I'm going to go. You know, the battery's going to be on zero. Yeah, a little mini heat wave's coming to California, and it's going to pick up tomorrow, like supposed to be what, in the mid-80s or 80-something, and then Wednesday's supposed to be 90-something, and then next day 80-something, so it's like a little three-day heat wave, and then some rain and showers, and cooler weather's coming back in April. But we are headed towards this separating of the parting of the ways between those who are aiming, believe that salvation comes from everyone going to the lowest common denominator. And so we think, okay, we're all one, we're all the same, we're all this lowest common denominator, and this is how we can all feel free from fear and paranoia. And then the others going to the highest common denominator. Which is God. Those two are completely opposite directions, actually. And that's always been the case. The ego tried to cover it up by saying there's some middle direction. How can there be a middle direction? It's crazy, isn't it? It's just like chaos. You could say chaos is a middle direction. That's what the ego gave me. He says, here's the middle direction. It's complete mental chaos. It's not a middle direction. It's just you're zigzagging back and forth. You know, it's ridiculous. There's no middle direction. So that's coming. Yoga girl communism is coming. Probably a financial crash is coming. Could be natural disasters that are coming. It is just the whole ball of wax, and the elites are heading underground. They're ready to head underground. In a matter of a month, you know, it could be a matter of just months away from this, from stuff. Now, at this point, I think late May, troubles may begin in late May, accelerate through June, and by we hit July 24th, we may realize, you know, that boom, you know, maybe just some severe collapse at that point. Maybe there's a meltdown of the stock, you know, financial system starts melting down, and then July 24th, it just collapses. At that point, we realize, you know, we're doomed. You know, this is the mindset of people, we're doomed. And then, you know, from that crisis and collapse, the yoga girl communists will jump on the scene and say, you know, okay, we're going to imprison the bad guys who brought this upon us. We're in control, and we're going to fix all this. Yeah. So it is all coming. The tsunami's coming. But what we're doing is we're focusing on the beautiful minds, our beautiful minds. So I keep trying to make beautiful videos. We have these four sister stations where I'll put these beautiful videos. I leave this one for these talks here, which are very important and helpful. I know a lot of people are used to these, and I enjoy doing these, and maybe this is better than these other videos, probably is. But these other videos, at least, I'm trying to remind you of how beautiful your mind is, you know, give you some way of reminder, and focus on how beautiful, because your mind is just as beautiful as the mind of Sri Sri Anandamayi. Your mind is absolutely that beautiful. Jesus Christ, same, just as beautiful, okay? This is true. This is absolutely true. And anything other than that is fake mind. It's not real mind. It's not true. It's not true. It's mind pretending. It's a rope pretending to be a snake. No, the mind is beauty. It's not just experiencing beauty. It is beauty. And it enjoys just ornamenting its own beauty. It ornaments its own beauty. So we need to remind ourselves and stay in tune with that instead of all the ugliness, because people are going to get real ugly. It's going to get real, real. It already is so ugly. I can't even watch the news or media or anything. I had to boycott it. It's too ugly. And I realize it's taking me away from the beauty of my mind, of the one mind. Your mind, my mind. It's all the mind of absolute beauty and freedom and love and peace. It absolutely is that. And so this focusing on the world takes us away from that severely, horribly, 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 horribly. You can't pick up, it's like newspapers, internet. You go to any internet site, any newspaper, any magazine, any entertainment. Everything is like radioactive. It's so toxic, it's radioactive. It's like, I go back for it, like, oh my gosh, that's super toxic. It's super toxic. It is not portraying what we are at all. It's trying to portray fake life, fake mind, and that's for the purpose of fake death. Make no mistake about it. Fakery, faking life is always for the purpose of sacrifice, fake death, in order to try and get rid of what we feel is threat, some t the terrible threat to us, which is ultimately our attraction to what we really are, our attraction to the true mind. Yeah, so they don't want us to look at beautiful mind. They want us to look at ugly mind. That minds are horrible. Minds are vicious. Minds are terrible. Isn't this awful? Isn't this awful? Look what these minds are doing. Ugh. Look at them. Get on this talk show. I mean, the people they put on there, it's all ugliness. It's all hideousness. It's all terribleness. You know, it's crime. It's so awful. Put your mind on Jesus Christ, and you find out how beautiful your mind really is. Put your mind on the Dharma King or Queen, and be reminded of how absolutely perfectly beautiful you are, because you are that mind. I am that mind. Say, I am that mind. I can be that mind. I will be that mind. I am already that mind, actually. I am already that mind, intrinsically so, without any effort on our part. We are that mind. Inherently so. So it is absolutely crucial to keep reminding yourself of this fact. And you cannot get it. It's so difficult to get this in the world. I'm trying my best to provide something that gives you some little boost, right? It's difficult. It really is. But I'm doing what I can do. And so these sister channels, actually a few people have subscribed to them. Thank you very much, and thank yourself for doing that, because I feel this will be helpful to you. Is put your mind on the sublime. And these Dharma kings and queens are very sublime. They're very sublime. I know we don't have photographs of Jesus or Longchenpa. We don't even have an image of Jesus in any way, what, shape, or form. At least we have statues of Longchenpa. And so we have some idea of what he looks like, actually. We have a pretty good idea of what he looks like. We don't have that of Jesus, unfortunately. Or fortunately, I don't know, whatever the case may be. But we do have pictures and video of Sri Sri Anandamayi and Ram Maharshi. And we can tell, wow, Jesus would be like this. The beauty of Jesus showed us of his mind would be the same beauty. You know, wow, it was just so amazing. So amazing. You can just see it. Oh my gosh, it's so sublime. You are that mind. You are that mind. Be absolutely certain of this. There's no difference. And this is when I met these teachers, I realized I am that. I knew it. I said, this is me. This is what I am. There's no doubt about it. It just has this, you know, fake body appearance, fake appearance, but shining through that fake appearance. This is me shining through that. I knew, this is how I felt. This is how I feel. This is me. Sri Sri Anandamayi is me. I am that. I am that. Ram Maharshi is me. I am that. Longchenpa is me. I am that. Jesus Christ is me. I am that. Just say, I am that. It's the one mind, the infinitely creative one mind. So, by all means, I'm putting up videos. I will be putting up videos. I'm working on it. You know, if I can keep working on it, we'll see. Posting them on these channels, these sister channels, and the links are links to these channels are in the video description. Click on Show More, and you'll see these links. And I'm putting up pictures on Google Plus, also graphics. You know, that's, you know, it's helpful. it's better to experience the creative mind directly in this imagery and visions that you have, this beautiful, beautiful creativity flowing, the flow. You know, that's even more powerful. And reading the books and the words is very helpful too. It's all helpful. It's all helpful to get these, you know, so-called reflections or pointers, remembrances, boosts to remind us that our mind is truly beautiful, and anything to the contrary is not so. So why focus on what is not so? What can we possibly get out of that, really? Right? Stay with the supremely positive right now. This is my advice. And anyone who can be a reminder, you know, hopefully they can do that. Hopefully I can do that at some point too, here coming up. It's just be someone who's just a reminder. There's no reflection of mind. It's in evanescence, right? In evanescent. In evanescent. We are in evanescent. In evanescent. And so, but we can make these crude reminders, very crude reminders here. You know. But it's better than no reminder at all, right? So, I hope I can help out. We'll see. You know, that maybe that's better than graphics. But, you know, it's kind of the whole wow ball of wax here. Let's get the whole, all of it. Let's get all of it. And pay no attention to the world. It doesn't matter. The play of absurdity will continue on until people repent and they just cycle through it. You go through these cycles, you go to the low, you go down, you go to this collapse, and then you build it back up, and then you collapse again, you build it back up, you collapse again. It just cycles through this like this. That's all. So there's nothing to see. You know, if you don't repent, it's just spinning your wheels. That's all that happens. It's cycling. Cycling is and to take the long-term viewpoint. You know, just work on repentance. The more repentance there is, the more it helps others. It reassures them they can repent too. And just do that. And this is the best, you know, this do all that you can do. This is the best you can do. Don't worry about how bad it gets here and the troubles that are happening. Because this is what happens in absurdist relativism. It's what happens. And they're trying not to wake up, trying to destroy God so they don't wake up. And they go into this relativism and they're lost. They seem like zombies. You can't talk with them. Yeah, you can't. You can't get through to them at all. You know, can't seem to do anything for them. It's frustrating. So we may need to distance ourselves from the whole situation because it's so frustrating. You feel like you can't help out. So, okay, that's enough for this one. I don't want to stay up too late. I still have video to work on. I want to give you this, you know, just the best I can do. I'm limited and got a really old computer and old software and everything's slow. But it's heartfelt, you know, it's homespun stuff. It's down home stuff that I do. I don't have some powerful, all these arrays. No, I've just got an old rinky dink laptop computer and that's it. And I use some free programs and that's it. that's it. That's all I do. But I'm able to do stuff that if you just like homespun down homeness and can relate to this and are not looking for something that's too slick, then, you know, it to me, I enjoy it. I get a wow out of it for sure. So this is, I really like this. So, you know, feel free to subscribe to these other channels because there will be some very nice stuff coming out on these other channels. You can click and follow and just subscribe because that will then let you know when something comes up on that channel, it'll be on your feed, right? And you'll say, oh, another video. Great, let me check it out. This will help remind me of how beautiful my mind is, how beautiful everyone's mind is, actually. Don't fall for these ridiculous pretensions. Everyone's mind is absolutely beautiful. Everyone. Without any exception, because there's just this one beautiful mind, the isness that is God. Very great. That's it for this one. Full stop in the wow.